I can, and I have a 2.5-page handout at the end, which will summarize loads and loads and give you loads and loads of stuff. So, I mean, from this webinar, I hope you'll get at least a day's reading and video stuff to explore. I'm hoping to give you something for beginners, false beginners, and intermediate. I'm not sure I can stretch myself to intermediate, but let's get it going. Thank you so much for coming to Ximena for organizing this. And again, apologies for the delay. What I'm going to do first is try and use some of the resources which I have in English ID, but which you can relatively easily find for yourself. So aspects might appear commercial, but trust me, with a little thought, you can dig around and find these things for yourselves. But of course, if you use ID, so much the better. So here we go. You've heard this video so many times now. How many questions do you have? I'm going to play a video to you twice. And I want you just to answer the two questions. How many questions do you hear? And which are the four question words you hear? Off we go.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why don't you sleep with me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Bit scary, isn't it? But then I would ask you to try and write them down, perhaps in your chat room. If you were in other rooms alongside, perhaps then you could talk to a study buddy or whatever. But I'm just asking you to try and challenge yourselves for the purposes of this. And I'll give you another chance this time. Try and order the question words as you hear them, and how many verb be questions, and which of them are negative. Okay. I think a lot of online teaching depends on the students testing themselves because they can't all feed back. So what I try to do is every time there is a listening or a repeat video segment, I think it's pretty imperative to change the question so you can pick up the fast and the slow. Here we go again.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? What do you know? Why don't you sleep with me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Okay, so I'm just demonstrating now. I won't chase the answers because we lost so much time. That's the answer. Seven questions. Give yourself a pat on the back or an extra point if you got it right. How many question words? You can type in your answers to Ximena if you wish. There were four. They go into there. I could then do that with you, but I won't because of time. How many verb be questions? There were two. How many negative questions? You can see the power of this, and all you need to do is get hold of this video or ask one of your techie students to download it for you. It's a great way to grab their attention when you're revising questions, which we so often do at the beginning of the class. Here's the answer just to satisfy.
What do you want from me? Why don't you run from me? What are you wondering? Why do you know? Why don't you sleep with me? Why do you care for me? When we all fall asleep, where do we go?
Okay, so if you got it all right, celebrate, wave your arm so I can at least see some celebration. I hope you did. Is everybody hearing this okay? Is it working now?
Yes, yeah, we're good.
I hope I'm not going too fast, but you can see the idea. It's changed the task, set it realistically, give students a chance to sort of evaluate themselves if you can't go into breakout rooms. And then sort of try and keep things moving with short, simple tasks. I was going to ask you for a point if you knew the song. That's the song, the title and the year, but there'll be more chances as I go and look at songs with you in another way. What I'm trying to do today is show you can do everything that we do normally, but with music, along the lines of what I do in English ID, but tweaked towards online teaching. Okay, so there'll be 10 online uses. That's what I wanted to do rather than talk to and struggle with the technology. I would have had that playing as you came in, not necessarily with a task at all, but just to grab the students' attentions. So many online classes begin as we began today with a sort of, can you hear me? Can't hear you, no video, etc. So I really think it's imperative to ask students to come in with something and, you know, what's this? It's my two-year-old's pet unicorn, and get everybody holding something and describing it. Just begin with a bang. That is a dictagloss. I think it's much better done like with a video too, because it's more interesting. All of this will be on the handout, so I'll go quite fast. I think it's imperative too, as you know, if you know English ID at all, that when we're teaching, we try and make pronunciation visual. Here's an example for you from a song which you know. You can see there, whether you're a brother, you probably know the song, which is the group. Anybody can tell Ximena, please. And also you can guess the year for an extra point. So whenever I teach like this, I always have sort of little point elements and guessing elements just by showing things bit by bit. You give the opportunity for students in the chat room to come in. If you look at the lyric there, you can see I've reduced the whether, the brother, the in brother. What I've done is reduced all the parts which are unstressed. There's the answer for you in case you want to give yourself another point. What I think is important is have students do this. Students are often asked to do bits of songs or whole songs or whatever. Personally, I never use whole songs. A lot of people look at ID and think, oh, we've got to use all these songs. I mean, no way. I think the key thing is to use the best bits. I think it's silly to use a whole song because you rarely find a whole song that everybody likes, and they can always go and do it for themselves anyway. You're much better using it pedagogically as a taster and just analysing a bit. But whenever my students now ask me, we want to do this, I say, well, first of all, I want you to do something to it in terms of pronunciation, show us the stress, etc., before we actually do it. In other words, they do the work. And often it puts them off using some of the more horrible songs. I've got four guests coming in today, if we have time. The first is Steve from Turkey. He's been observing Turkish teachers, and I've got 12 key observations he's made looking at Turkish teachers moving online from standard face-to-face classes. And these are two of the points which I've tried to pick up on at the beginning. The start is never really very good. You know, just ask them to do something, touch your nose, scratch your head, look out the window or something. And also lesson aims, in his experience, a lot of teachers aren't really clarifying their aims. They're just jumping in and getting on with it. So these are two things. Again, this will all be on the handout for you. There are 12 points in all. These are all the weaknesses newer teachers have had. What I suggest you do, again, is give a lesson plan at the beginning, much as I tried to today. Which do you think of those two lesson plans is the more appealing to students? One is a bit like a puzzle. Two looks like a science class. And I think it's what I tried to do using, here's another one below. Which of those do you think, if you just put a little puzzle up on your screen to begin the class, which one do you think is going to draw the students in more? The one on the left, the menu, or the standard plan? To my mind, you're much better off setting things in a puzzle way, the same as I'm trying to do with the songs as well. Make it puzzle-like and get the students to work it out. How will they work it out? Well, they'll contrast mentally. And a lot of the content you'll see today, I'm encouraging you to use much more translation because you're not in the classroom. So it's less imperative that students are blah, 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 blah all the time in English. It's much more important, I think, that you draw English from the students, but you allow them to make the inevitable references to the mother tongue. And this, as you know, is built in to... Do you like the idea? If you do, please give Ximena some feedback. I think it's easy to express the aims of any lesson in terms of what mistakes will the students make in this lesson, and then try and anticipate them, put them at the front of the class, so when they come in, they notice the mistake. Obviously, they're translating and noticing that this is what I would say if I were using my mother tongue, and it primes them to the content of the class much more than the sort of traditional lists we give them on the right. This is obviously, from English ID, the common mistake system, but I'm encouraging you to try and think about it creatively, try and front your lessons with it. This is what I've been doing for years and years. It's weeding the obvious translation mistakes out, putting them on the board. The students work them out by mental translation, so they're thinking between the languages, and guess what? That's what they do all the time. We say don't translate, but it's always too late. They've already translated. So what I've done is find a way to use my knowledge of their language to help them help themselves in a more intelligent way. And because it's puzzle-like, it's interesting, it's intriguing, rather than just the standard on a plate inductive or deductive approach. And this is an English idea. Again, sorry if I'm a little bit commercial, but you know, this is how I'm earning my living at the moment. And it's very difficult to do so locked down in England. What's happening here is I'm in Brighton at the moment, just so you know, it's very, very sunny. It's very difficult to keep people indoors because people in England automatically go out. If you're interested, I'm wearing shorts at the moment. So, and it's only 20 degrees. So that's what happens to us English here. Anyway, there you go. If you're interested in reading about this on the handout I'll give you, I've written an article called Inductive, Deductive or Seductive. And there's the link there. And it's in a wonderful magazine, which I'd like to publish. It's produced by Paul Davis in Mexico. It's of use to all of us Latin American teachers. He's got some wonderful articles in there. You can find it through that link, which I'll give you at the end. Some more observations from Steve's. They're all for you to read through. I think they're fairly obvious, but they're traps that we all fall into at the beginning. A good one, I thought, is try and use more open pair work. So, you know, Marion, ask Paul, John, tell Linda, etc. Just something which I don't like to do in the classroom. I tend to sort of put students into pairs and do it. But I think initially, just to get the students speaking more, I found myself doing more open pair work. To trying to avoid obviously one dominant student. Many of the classes Steve's seeing in Turkey, the teacher is sort of talking to the strong student and praying for the rest and then moving on, leaving so many people behind. I think the key thing, which those of you who've seen me in my videos on YouTube, but also in talks I've given, it's all about a small amount, a short time, and then share. Teachers, if you're talking for more than a minute, as I am now, this is a presentation, it's not a class, you have no idea, because they're not all going to chat. Most of them will say yes teacher, no teacher. You need the breakout rooms and the chat windows to get feedback, and you can't do that if you're blathering away. So I think teacher speak has to be even shorter online to get responses, whether it's largely written response, that's okay, at least it's a response. The worst type of teaching which he's seen is when the teacher just play a 3-minute listening. And of course, the students say, again, teacher, after that. And so you've played it for 6 minutes and the students haven't said anything. Again, I think we really need to be reducing things down to short bursts. Play a bit, pause, compare, play a bit, pause, write down something you've understood, share, 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 breaking things up. It may not be a natural flow, but it's a much better class. Otherwise, you're going to lose students. And then there are more things which I'd like you to read afterwards. all of that will be available to you. I hope it's useful. Here's my second guest, who's a local neighbour of mine, and she's an expert on one-to-one teaching. Her name is Renata. She's Brazilian, but you wouldn't know it, I don't think, from her pronunciation. Welcome, Renata.
Hi, everyone. Renata Delaney from English This Way here. I hope you are enjoying Paul's webinar. He asked me to give you some tips on online teaching and also on subtitles. So let's do this. Now I'd like to share with you my 3 C's of online learning. I had to do a lot of research on online pedagogy when I started my business in 2016. I came across a very famous theory by Professor Julie Salmon. So she has 5 stages. I highly recommend you have a look at that. But I'm going to share with you now the 3 C's, which are related to her 5 stages, but I kind of simplified things for my own sake. So let's have a look at the 3 C's and what they mean. My first C of online learning is communication. That's where everything starts. That's where you're going to leave your students with the first good impression. So how you communicate with them, how you model your communication online are 2 essential things that you need to think before you start doing anything. Are you going to communicate with them via WhatsApp? How are you going to communicate with them in the chat box? How are you going to communicate with them orally? How are you going to communicate with them via email? Are you going to use a VLE? You need to establish your communication first thing before you do anything. And make sure it's sweet and short. My second C of online learning is collaboration. You need to make sure your online lessons are student-centered. So how can you do that online? You have to make sure you offer your students opportunities to share their screen, to share their notes online, that they are typing full answers in the chat box, that they are sending you audio recordings with their speaking homework, that they are the center of attention, and you are enabling online collaboration. You can promote collaboration via social media, via forums on your virtual learning environment, via email. Make sure you foster opportunities for collaboration online. My last C of online learning is content. You have to make sure your content is available to your students before, during, and after your lesson. Make sure your content is engaging. So don't use only PowerPoint slides. Make sure you use video, use social media, use virtual learning platforms, use audio files, use podcasts. There are so many things you can do with content nowadays. Don't rely on PowerPoint only. Don't be afraid to experiment with different things. For example, now I am in the jungle and there's a snake. If you're wondering how I recorded this video, I used my mobile phone and I used Clips. Clips is an app that's available to you if you have an iPhone. There are Android versions as well, but it's very simple and quick, and you can add captions. So Paul asked me about one way to add subtitles to your videos, and this is one way. So you can record your videos on Clips and add subtitles, like you can see these ones here. If you liked these tips, you can contact me and learn more about my online challenge for teachers. So it's a 30-day challenge where I give practical advice and share ideas on what you can do to practice and learn more about online teaching. I hope you enjoyed this webinar and good luck with your teaching. Bye.
Okay, so that's Renata, and you've got her contact there. I thought it would just break things up. It's a little bit like having a commercial break. Most of the webinars I've been asked to do are very long. I mean, I think an hour is quite a long time. So I've tried to bring a few friends along. You've seen Steve, you've seen Renata, and you've got another surprise guest coming along. But talking of, I'd still a quick commercial moment for me. If you go to the digital material of IRD now, it's much, much improved. We've got video watching it with or without subtitles, and then the students are able to actually interact with the characters. They can play either role. How they do this, they do activities to prepare themselves like this, and then they record themselves in a conversation with one of the characters. They can play either role. They can be Paolo or they could be Lucy, and then they can listen back to themselves and evaluate their own performance. It's really nice. That's the video from the course book. Number four in terms of uses of authentic song extracts online. I'm going to play you a little clip from a song, and I want you to find three words or phrases that rhyme with famous. And again, you can see the power there of adding in the clips subtitles, as Renata explained to you. But how often do we work with rhyme? And I think it's really important that we explore the pronunciation element of songs. I was going to ask you who it was. If you wrote it down, try and write down the name of the group and the year, you win extra points. No money, I'm afraid, you just get points. But perhaps one day I'll give you a few pennies, who knows. Also underlining cognates. False friends, for example, I think we really should be celebrating much more all the advantages our students have as Spanish and Romance language speakers, Portuguese speakers. All too much of what we do is international. A lot more of what we do should be tailored around what our students already know because of the strengths of their mother tongue. For example, in this, the students, I asked my Brazilian students to pick out cognates, and they found four, and they're the same virtually. Three, and they found the same ones virtually in Spanish. Translation, let's look at some translation activities. Translation, I think, is a really useful activity with songs because it's what students do anyway, and there are lots of websites which students use all the time to do this. So let me give you a couple of examples. All these songs happen to be in the book, but you can do these things with any songs you like. Do you recognize that song? Anybody know the singer? Pat yourself on the back if you do, and the year. This is what I would ask students to do perhaps before class, or I think a good idea when you're online teaching is to actually begin the class at, say, let's say 9 o'clock, but then not turn your camera on until 9:30 and set a number of tasks, for example, translation tasks, where students are working alone and they have no one to speak English to anyway. It seems to me we can explore the powers of translation much more in that environment. So often if you ask the students, okay, the class begins at 9, you must start at 9, but I'm not turning my camera on until 9:30, then give them a series of tasks like these. Okay, and they this is what Google Translate provides. And then ask them to compare the two languages. In English, it's always several more words than Spanish, a few more words than Portuguese. We'll look at another example in a minute. There are the interesting contrasts, and there's a lot to talk about there. And even if you don't talk about it, the students are learning a hell of a lot there. I use this song to teach irregular and regular past tenses, but you can use it. Look at the grammatical information they're getting from there within that too. And the interesting differences, for example, about object pronouns, lo has various meanings, and le also can mean him, for example, just in Spanish. So you could just begin to see, let me give you another example straight away, so you don't get bored, but also, again, who's that? Give yourself a point if you know. The year, perhaps, another point, there we go. Translate it again. This time I've included Portuguese, just to add interest. So we've got it in Spanish first, in Portuguese. How many words in English? More in Portuguese than Spanish, but both less than English. Highlight the extra words again. Look at the differences. It's really interesting, just contrasting Spanish and Portuguese. But look at the two versions at the top, and I've highlighted in red in the three versions, Spanish, Portuguese and English, all the interesting bits you could talk about. So whether the song is fitting lexically or grammatically, or whatever your connection to the lesson may be, there's always a lot more content you can exploit through activities like this. How much preparation for you? Or none whatsoever, provided you don't mind the student switching between the languages. And obviously, Google Translate is interesting. There's several examples you'll see of the weaknesses of Google Translate. We could talk about that as well. Instead of soul, it could be for, which should be for example. So that's looking for interesting differences. Or we could do the same thing in reverse. This is called reverse translation. Sorry, I'm jumping ahead. English to Spanish or Portuguese. Delay perhaps the next class, get them to do it back into English, and then compare. And when you think about it, translation forces noticing. I mean, noticing is a key objective of any teaching situation. Nothing makes you notice more than translation. When you actually move between the languages, you notice all the subtle little things that we perhaps as teachers have forgotten or never taught or take for granted. So I'm really in favor of this sort of thing. Yes, they're going to be speaking Portuguese and Spanish, but they're largely working on their own unless you're using breakout rooms and things. And I think this process is massively informative, because if they start to choose the songs, then which they obviously will, you can really, really take this far. You could do it the other way. Anybody recognize that song? I've got it in Spanish and English. This is just Google Translate, so it's not perfect, but it's not bad. It's actually a lot better than it was 2 years ago. Anybody got it? There's a clue there. Singer. And guess the year if you can. And then obviously I'm going too fast, but with a class, that's how I would do it. Try and make it much more playful. Ping, pong. Ping, pong, ping, pong. Introducing things just one by one allows people to sort of interact, whether it be in writing or mentally or on paper or interactive whiteboard or whatever you're using. Contrast, highlight the extra words, and that's where we get all the differences there again. And I think that's a valid activity. I wonder if you do. I'll look forward to seeing some of the feedback you give to Jimena. I won't actually stop and take questions now, simply because we lost so much time at the beginning. But please signal to Jimena if you like that sort of thing. I think it's fantastic, and it's exactly what students do anyway. And the notion of working with authentic materials is only feasible, I think, if you're working with relatively short authentic materials, particularly with lower levels, where students have some say in which material you're actually using. I ask them, if you don't like my Ariana song, for example, then please suggest one which connects to the lesson which you do like, and then we can work on it. You can prepare it a little bit, perhaps look for things that we need to find as teachers and students. Another day, come back with it. this time gapped, and see if they can complete the song and take it back to its original version. There's so many things you can do just playing backwards and forwards with things. And of course, once students get the idea, they can set these tasks for each other. It's much more intriguing than your standard app type exercise where students are just sort of chunking vocabulary or mechanically operating grammar. It's much more interesting to play, I think, with little authentic English. And of course, they've got the pronunciation whenever they want to. So it gives them this massive input of chunks of real language, insights and real language. Many people call translation the fifth skill. I agree. I mean, you can't really work between languages unless you're able to move between them, which is what we're training students to do. And there's a book for you, which I've quoted here, and I'll quote again in the reference. To my mind, that was the best book published 5 years ago now. Wow, it's gone quickly. It's full of good ideas. I highly recommend it. Seven more. Get students then to find the best or the worst video versions of any songs you're using. Bring next lesson. Google alternatives. You will know about Vagalume if you live in Brazil. Virtually every song you need provides that translation, so it's easy for students to start doing this. Musics Match is the best one I found for Spanish songs, and just in case any of you are still in the 20th century, every student on earth loves lyrics training, so if you're not recommending that, then please do. I'm sure you know them all. Getting students to sing it or try and record it in different styles. This really does appeal to certain sort of types of students, those who are into karaoke and stuff. And karaoke is actually the best pronunciation activity in the world, funnily enough. And it gets students to illustrate the grammar. For example, if you ask, for next lesson we're going to have revised conditionals, for example. For homework, what I'd like you to bring to class or in your first 10 minutes online before I actually turn on my camera, look for a song with if. And they, all you need to do is Google if lyric and you'll find lots and lots of songs. Probably if they go through their phones, they can find one in a title. I've done this many, many times. Here's an example which I got with Used To. This was last year I taught a class in exactly that way. For class, find all the songs that you can, preferably that you like, with Used To in. And then they came up with these and some more, which I've cut out because of the screen size. And then we work through them and we pick out, you know, what do you notice about Used To? When is it followed by an infinitive? When is it followed by ing? And all the standard stuff. But it's real and the students are producing material. They have much more control and obviously much more interest. And it's also sharing each other's culture. Guess what? Ding-a-ling-a-ling, commercial moment. It's what it says. There are that many songs in the six levels of English ID and identities. Happy Christmas. Also now, just so you know about the second edition, the teacher's notes are fabulous. Now we've got at least 45, I counted, different techniques for songs. Here's the song I use now to teach or revise the present simple. And these notes explain exactly how to do it and when to do it during the lesson. So if you read through that section on the back of the teacher's book, it's a complete methodology in different ways of using song lines. There's the example, put it on the board or type it in with a mistake, the students find it, and that's your lead in for the third person. Yes, it's the hook rather than just explaining rules, something which they can sing again and should help them to remember. So that's what I'm suggesting we should be doing using ID or any coursebook. I can't imagine teaching without regular bursts of music these days. Also now on Spotify, if you go to that list, I'll give you the list. We've just uploaded English ID 1 songs are all there, so you don't need to do any work if you don't want to. We're putting all the others on as fast as we can. But again, if you're using the My Material or any song-based material, any student who has Spotify can upload all the songs for you. Just a little joke. We're all looking for a cure, and there they are, the cure. I don't know I'm getting hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different funny memes. I was going to show you some of them, but of course we haven't got time. I suspect you're all sharing memes like these at the moment in your countries. Okay, another guest, Carol Letherby, my co-author on levels 1 and 2 of ID. I asked her to contribute some websites, and this is what she has come up with. If you're an early Zoomer, then a bit like me this morning, then there are some basic functions for you. And then there's some more detailed things from social media. I won't dwell on these because they're all in the handout for you to go and chase. All highly recommended by somebody I respect and admire. Carol has been teaching online for years and is an expert. Back to ID. Just, I was asked to talk briefly about the digital platform because it's remarkable how many teachers still don't use all the digital materials. I mean, we're being forced online, and I was speaking to several experts, and they reckon still the best place to deliver online classes is through the publisher's platforms, because you've got so much material there already and you can easily upload your own onto the material. So it's not really being commercial about my platform. All platforms now are probably, are the heartbeat of a lot of good online teaching, particularly if you're trying to take students through an exam and you have to cover what's there. Most of what you need online can be found in your good publisher's platforms. Here are some examples from English ID: grammar exercises, we've got functional exercises, the students have a mark book, you have a mark book, the students have two attempts before they can see the answers. You can see what happens when they try the first time, when they try the second time, and then you enter their mark into the mark book. So it's much easier to monitor what they are or aren't doing. One of the online problems is we set so much. Flipping, for example, the idea of setting tasks before a class often falls down because the students haven't done it. At least with the platforms, you can see what they have or haven't done and actually reprimand if need be. Taking you back to the students, but again, something in English ID which people don't always notice is that we've got a wonderful built-in picture dictionary with 400 words per level, which students can be sent to revise. If the technology goes wrong, send them to test themselves by covering the words, look at the image, etc. What I like about this is it's always contextualized, so it helps them remember. And also it sensibly does. So many books have a slab, a really large vocabulary section at the back of the book, which has too many words at once, and it's very hard to deal with in short bursts in class. And then, again, some teachers haven't noticed this, but in the review classes, we have a built-in picture dictionary. This is from ID2, sending them back and forth to pages, again, all for self-testing. So these are the sorts of tasks I would be setting students if I were using English ID with online classes, for them to catch up, work alone, fill in time at the beginning of the class. If you can have the camera off moments with this sort of thing before you turn the camera on, my feeling is it's easier for you to manage and the more likely to do some of these flipping tasks. Not flipping as in awful, but flipping as in see it first and then polish with the teacher. Another activity I really like is that English ID has all the question type, the lesson titles in English ID are questions. So you have a syllabus. And these are great for memorizing. And every time I've had a technical problem, if you do have breakout rooms or if your students do have study buddies, and I recommend you always allocate a study buddy, they can go onto WhatsApp or Google or whatever they're using to communicate, and they can actually ask and answer these questions, perhaps before the class, during the class, or after the class. So you've got a whole syllabus in each book just in the question titles. Would you like Ximena to choose one of those to ask me now, just to prove that it works?
What are you going to do next year?
I haven't got a clue. Everything's been cancelled. Hopefully, come to your continent and see all you wonderful people again, but fingers crossed. I would like to ask you back, but the session will never end. Thank you, Ximena. Also, there's an e-workbook, which is trackable now. E-workbooks are much more popular and combining with online classes, and that's how the mark book works. You can see there's some pages from the book, that sort of thing. The students get two attempts, and they only get to see the answers after they've tried twice. So if they got 10% the first time, the teacher gets to see that. If they got 50% the second time, that's their mark that goes into the book. If they didn't do it, the teacher has a way of chasing them up. My feeling is this is wonderful for online teaching. And why go away and make up your own stuff if you've got all this readily available? And I do think that that was always the problem with Dogme, that, you know, how do students revise without regularly revisiting the same material? Another visitor for you, This time, a very close friend of mine, you'll probably all know him. If you don't, this is a gift for you. Happy Christmas.
Hi, this is Russell Stannard from Teacher Training Videos. I hope you're enjoying Paul's talk. Paul asked me if I could recommend a few useful websites or videos to help you to learn about teaching online. So I've prepared a special handout, and in that handout there are links to some really useful videos, how to use Edmodo, how to use Zoom, some ideas about how to make your lessons a little bit more interesting, and also some of the collaboration tools that you can use when teaching online as well. So to receive the handout, all you need to do is email me, russellhandout@gmail.com. That's russellhandout, all one word, russellhandout@gmail.com. In the subject, just write Paul's talk, and then all you need to write is, hello, I am. Tell me your name, from, and tell me where you're from. Automatically, you will receive the handout. It's got help with Zoom, it's got help with Edmodo, it's got some great tips on using collaboration tools to make your online learning more interesting. And I really hope that the video is useful. And I also hope that you're really enjoying today, Paul's talk, and thank you very much.
Isn't he lovely? I would love to know, perhaps you could signal to him, how many of you have heard of teachertrainingvideos.com? If you haven't, he's one of my best resources, as well as being a good mate and a very good guy. He's one of the best resources I've come across for basically taking teachers into the technological world.
Some of the teachers here might have been in the three-day course he offered with Donna a couple of weeks ago. So some of the teachers in this room might already know him, because we did offer a three-day course with him and Donna a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, I met them both in Turkey recently. That's where I was when the lockdown started. I had to race back from Turkey with Donna rushing back to Spain and Russell and I rushing back to England before we were closed out. Yeah, he's a great guy. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi again, Russell. Bye, Russell. I've created three different pronunciation charts, and this is the best one, I think, because it's based on rhyme. If you don't know the material, you don't need to use the material to use this at all, but it's really good. You've got three, tree, e, six, mix, pick, e, book, cook, etc. What I like about this in particular is it's great for students to pick out where they should focus. I mean, you don't need to focus on all the sounds. That's one of the problems with international course books, is they focus on sounds which your students don't have a problem with. And here you can, I've identified where they do need to focus. And I think it's a really useful thing, again, for teachers to send students to work on their own. And what I'm trying to foster is an attitude of, thank God we speak Spanish or Portuguese, rather than see Spanish and Portuguese as the enemy. Something which is fundamental is that an A1 or an A2 or a B1 Spanish speaker or Portuguese speaker, Latin American, is infinitely richer than an A1, A2 or B1 Chinese or Arabic speaker, because they can read so much more, because they've got access to so many more words. And for too long, we've been sort of classifying all these people internationally. Latinos and Brazilians, everybody in our continent should, or your continent at the moment, but mine in my heart, everybody should be learning English more quickly. And the reason they don't is because we simply haven't been tailoring things to their advantages. So this is the sort of thing you can find online now. They can record themselves and compare, you know, pajamas, bananas in pajamas. They can say various things. With the consonants, they've got the same thing. Which is a wonderful resource. Students love this sort of thing. They often buy apps just to do the same thing. But the thing is here, all the words which I'm using are recycled in the material. So again, one of the problems with apps is random. The beautiful thing about courses is they recycle. This is what I've been doing with a group recently, just getting them to create silly sentences with the images, like pig eating a pie, a bird on a bike, a monster with a medal. There's so much you can do with these things. If you want to, just a little bit of imagination. Once the students get going, I've had full tongue twisters generated by students with very little English just around these pictures. And beneath the chart, if you look carefully, there are the spelling patterns. How much time now do you give to spelling? How much honestly how the current course materials, international course materials, have been, in my experience, pretty weak on spelling. What I'm trying to do is help students an awful lot more than has been, and this is what you get in the book. And then what I've been asking students to do as interesting tasks around my online classes is have them find more examples of each pattern, or find the most common pattern, or find rhyming words, or find short poems. I haven't got time to show you today, but you can imagine the sorts of things they can get up to just from this. Is a wonderful trigger. And if you think about it, what, in my experience, Spanish speakers, for example, have greater problems with English spelling than they do with English grammar. So why don't we give a little bit more help with spelling like this? Another thing which you've got uniquely in English ID, I have to point these things out, because if you've got the material, you should, I think, really be exploiting it in these times. You've got pronunciation activities in every class. All you need to do is ask students to listen again through the platform, whatever, and do the pronunciation activities. For example, where do our students, Spanish and Portuguese speakers, have problems with m and m? It's at the end of words, whereas normally we're teaching sort of monkey and nose, initial position, but the real problem comes at the end of words. So what I've done is focus on the difficulties which our students have and try and help them. And the homework, all they need to do is write down an example of each of the different spelling patterns, the double M, single N, double N, N-E, and so on. There are 84 activities like this just in level one. There are over 300 throughout the book, and all of them are relevant to our students. So it's, that's one of the problems with pronunciation teaching. I think so much of what we have in our course books isn't relevant, so we've ended up skipping for far too long. So that's what I've done. A little bit commercial, but it's really interesting material, and I think I'm very proud of this, because I'm sure other books will start to copy this in the future. But you saw it here first. All right. I'm getting near the end now, so if you've got any questions or anything, please type them in towards Jimena. I've got about another 5 or 6 minutes to go, so take a deep breath, and we're nearly there. These are some more cross-lingual activities using translation, language contrast, language comparison, not just to explain meaning quickly or as bilingual dictionaries, but for example, contrastive analysis, taking you back to the common mistakes, sorting mistranslations. How much time now do you have to spend working out what hasn't quite been translated correctly by machines? It's a totally normal and natural skill for the 21st century. Reverse translation we've looked at. Having students agree which is the best version when you go from, for example, English to Spanish and then back to English, and then contrast which of their versions is better. Same with songs, beginning with a text in the mother tongue going the other way. All of these things have a huge validity, particularly if the students are choosing the text. And the secret is short text. Don't do the whole song, don't do even the whole poem, just short statements, quotations, proverbs, things which students really are interested in. Bilingual resources, well, we all know they're infinite now. I mean, how often do you use Google Translate, for example, or equivalent? I use it all the time, just to check when I'm moving between Spanish and French and Portuguese. I so often confuse them, so I have to go, I'm using it regularly for checking. Preparation is great. Again, my idea of having students sign into the class at 9 o'clock, and then you turn your camera on, but there's a series of activities for them to do at the beginning, and during that phase you can iron out the technological problems, for example, that we had today. Parallel readers, glossaries, and so on. I only ask students now to gloss false cognates. I'll show you an example in a second. Building their own phrase books. This is the obvious way to learn a language, isn't it? Asking students through translation to, you can give them lists of classroom language, you can give them lists of online language. There's a reference here at the bottom, which I'll share with you, of a colleague of mine, my co-author Luis Otavio, who co-wrote Identities 1 and 2 with me. He has a wonderful whole video class there for sort of B1-ish students, which you can download and use, just teaching them online phrases, but also proverbs and quotations. Bilingual phrase books, which you build yourself, must be of use. And of course, you can hear them now when you put them into the voice functions and audio functions on the computer. looking for cognates, looking for false cognates. We've looked at one example. Do you know the proportion of cognates to false cognates? Most of us have obsessed all our lives about false cognates, but there are at least 9 real cognates for every false cognate. 9 to 1. It's a fabulous advantage for our students. As I say, I only in my material now have a glossary for false cognates. They don't need a glossary for words which they can guess. And if you mark the pronunciation, as I do, they can guess an awful lot of language. This is an activity which one of my students wrote. I asked them to write an exercise. This was a B2 student, wrote an exercise around cognates. And there, of course, you'll know, I'm sure if you speak Spanish, are the answers, these soportar, realizar, embarazado, constipado, and libraria, for example, are all false cognates, that type of thing. Getting students to actually write their own exercises around false cognates is a really useful thing. When students are giving presentations, if you're still forced to do that, so often one student stands up and says, mi favorite te ame de futebol, and they speak awful, awful English. Nobody understands anything. Then everybody says, that was great at the end. What I try and ask them to do now is when you're giving a presentation about your favorite soccer team, a recipe, whatever, prepare a glossary and share it with the students so that other people can actually understand more and notice when you're using some of these difficult words, so they actually learn something from it. And then Renata earlier showed us how to subtitle. I've also been beginning to work now with dubbing. And I think more and more now online, there are sites, if you just Google how to dub, you can learn how to do it. So one way I've done it is ask students to watch a clip, which I have the transcript for, then I give out the transcript. The students translate it into L1. It could be just alone with a offline, quickly have a go, then put them online through the message board or whatever. Then they could then compare with the actual dubbed version in Spanish, so their subtitles they compare with the Spanish ones, and then choose their own clip and try and put a dub onto it themselves. It's really, really good fun. Again, all very short sequences. All of these things, particularly if you've got a large class, you've got a lot to look at, but this is how I wish my teacher had taught me when I, many, many years ago, was learning the various languages which I know. So I hope that's useful. All of it, as I say, is on the handout, which I'll share with Jimena in a second. Thank you very much for aguantating me. I hope it's been useful. I've rushed a bit because I wasn't quite sure how to get this in. I hope you've enjoyed meeting my friends, my guests, and do please fire away with your questions. And as always, enjoy your teaching, because if you don't, who will? Thank you very much for aguantating me, or aguantating me, depending where you're from. Over to you.
Right, I'm monitoring the chat room here in case there are questions. We're getting lots of great thank yous. Remember that for access to the recording of this webinar, you should contact your local Richmond representative. And once I get the handout from Paul, we will be sending it to you to the email address you used to register for this session. So lots of thank yous, Paul. Thank yous, thank yous, thank yous.
Not hello, actual all my students. I wish I could. I wish I could hug you. I wish I could touch you or even see you all. But I'm sure there's lots of people out there I love very much. So hi, guys. And I do hope I can see you before the end of the year.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you very much for a wonderful webinar. Lots of thank yous here from teachers. Thank you, teachers, for joining us. And Paul, talk to you soon. Take care. Okay. And thank you.
Nice to see you all. Take care, guys.
Bye.
Bye.